Welcome to another edition of Spoiler Alert here on 90.3 FM, where we watch movies and we spoil them for you. My name is Gian, and I'm here with my co-host,
Scott Yunker. And today, I'm really excited. We got our second guest star of the show's history.
Round of applause.
First female guest star. International Women's Day, so this is historic.
Historic moment. It is a day of firsts. It's also the first day we're going to be spoiling a children's movie. Up until this point, we've kind of been in a lot of R-rated action movies,
right.
Stuff. But now we're doing a Disney movie,
doing
today,
some
mixing
stuff.
It up. You know what? I'm just gonna throw this out there. Is it me or are we getting a lot of weird reverb?
Yeah,
right now?
I hear myself.
Right in the headphones.
I can hear myself.
How about now?
I can hear myself now. That's good. Keep going.
Okay.
We're gonna roll with it.
Hopefully the sounds all right out in Radio Land. So we're going to be talking about Zootopia, new Disney movie, with the lovely Laura French here, who saw the movie with us, offer her opinions on this film.
Oh yeah, I got some opinions.
Oh, she's ready. So you know what, I think as always we're gonna start this episode by playing a clip of the film. I'm going to the list here. Let's open it up with a scene in which the main character of the film, Judy Hopps, a rabbit, finds herself at her new job at a police station in Zootopia, a city lived in by a bunch of anthropomorphic animals. So we're going to play that, and when we come back, talk a little about this movie.
Hey.
I've got three items on the docket. First, we need to acknowledge the elephant in the room. Francie. Happy birthday. Number two, there are some new recruits with us I should introduce, but I'm not going to because I don't care. Finally, we have 14 missing mammal cases. All predators,
it just
helped, right? Polar bear, teensy little otter. And City Hall is right up my tail. This is priority number one.
Alrighty, so that's a clip from the film Zootopia. Kind of sums up the kind of the plot of the film in that one scene starring Idris Elba as the grumpy police chief.
What kind of animal is he?
A water buffalo?
A yak? No, he's probably a water buffalo, not a yak.
You know who the yak was? I think the groovy, like, psychedelic...
Oh, yeah, that was
dude
a yak.
In the animal nudist
that was
place.
Yak.
He was
yeah,
yak.
You're right. You know what? I was wrong. That's right.
So,
that's
he might
yak.
Have been
a was
water
he a
buffalo?
New? What's a new?
A new.
Is a new another word for a yak?
A new?
I don't know, not up
a
GNU.
I know nothing about nope. Animals. I know dogs and cats.
Yeah.
And ducks.
Also fish.
Fish. Well,
maybe.
Well, what do you mean, well?
I don't know.
Are you questioning whether or not fish
is
an animal?
No, fish don't fall into their own categories.
I mean, there weren't any fish in this movie, were there?
You know what? That's a weird fact.
They left
about this
all
movie.
Aquatic animals out.
Fish,
it was all mammals. Right?
It was all mammals. There were no fish.
Wow.
There were no reptiles, amphibians.
So what is it? A world without aquatic animals?
Which I mean, it's like this. It's an inconsequential fact, but it's also like so odd. Like, why wouldn't there be? Like, if you have a world like populated by like talking lions and tigers and bears, like why not have a talking bird? Like, is yeah,
turtles are so popular. And there were no turtles.
Turtles?
Yeah, they really should have did the
yes,
turtle market.
Turtles?
Love turtles.
You know?
There were no turtles. And there were no... Were there dogs? There were no dogs.
Whoa.
Or cats.
You're just blowing my mind right now.
They left out so many animals.
So...
It's just a world of, like, exotic animals. And just rabbit.
And I
sorry,
like
I'm
going to
start butchering
animals.
It like I always do.
Okay, you know, before we really get into the... Before we really have that Zootopia... we'd do well if we like talked about what this movie's about.
Yeah.
So this movie is at least Disney movie. It, you know, it's an animated feature, but it's not coming out of Disney's Pixar branch of filmmaking. Their Pixar studio, even though it feels very much like a Pixar film.
Byron Howard directed it.
Yeah. I'm not familiar with his work. I'm assuming he has done other animated films. So this film, yes, it takes place.
He did Lilo and Stitch.
Oh,
he did the character design. And he was supervising.
I just rewatched Lilo and Stitch for the first time in years the other week. It's so good.
Ooh,
like a lot of childhood memories.
He did a lot of animal movies. I'm looking at
We're looking at his filmography here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, animal movies.
Something called Super Rhino.
Don't know that one.
Yeah. Well, somebody should contact them and let them know that there were no dogs or cats in the movie.
Apparently, that's problematic. You know, the representation of dogs and cats in this film.
Dude, those are
really
like
underrepresented.
Those are like your top animals. Those are your go-to when you think. I think animal, dog, automatically.
Mm-hmm.
And they just left them out.
Maybe it's like animals that live like mostly in the wild. Like.
Yeah, I think that's what they were going for.
Yeah.
Because I think part of the fun
that
of the
movie. That you would see at a zoo. It's a Zootopia.
Exactly.
You're not gonna see like a Yorkshire Terrier.
You know what would be really funny?
What?
If they had humans as pets. That would have been really funny.
Like
that's a whole different movie.
Like, and I just imagine like a human being lit around
on a leash,
and that just leads into this whole like dark like BDSM territory. I don't know if I want to go into.
Okay, Scott, I wasn't thinking all that. You took it so dark.
I'm sorry. I immediately thought of a human on a leash too, so I don't know.
Yeah, no.
Okay,
Laura and I, we're on the same
level.
We're on the same plane.
Bad idea. I'd be that guy in the writing room. They're like, no,
no,
shut down. We're not putting people on leashes.
So Zootopia is this weird world where only populated by exotic mammals. There, like that's like if you have to be a mammal and you have to be a pretty exotic wild animal, and they all while we learn that there are towns in rural areas of the world, such as the burrows where the rabbits live. On their carrot farms.
That was pretty cool. But did they separate the actual city into divisions?
Yes. So, like, the main hub of this universe is a gigantic metropolis called Zootopia. And this is just a weird aside. Apparently, in other countries, it was released as Zootropolis. I don't know why they changed the name. Anyway.
I like Zootopia better.
So do I.
Zootropolis doesn't sound right.
Zootopia, it's got a better ring to it.
It does.
Anyway, so in this city where the majority of all these animals live, the city is divided into several districts, each, you know, different animals that are different districts, each of which is adapted to a specific climate or habitat. So you have Tundra Town,
right.
which is very cold, where the polar bears live. You have the Rainforest District, and you have Sahara Square,
mm-hmm.
where all the desert creatures live. And then you have Downtown, which is just like a regular city. And then, there's an area where the little animals live called Little Rodentia.
Yeah, it
was
the mice.
That was like the best part of the movie. The shrews and the mice and the rats and like
every
the
time
gerbils.
A hamster or a mouse came on, Scott like, oh, and I was like, oh.
It was so cute.
He was really
like,
big
it was
little,
cute.
Little
like they were just these little pudgy little balls of fur that squeak adorably. Like I'm a sucker for cute animals. Like I adored it. I was just like, oh. Like they could just like show like I would gladly sit down
like a short
and watch like a 3-hour long movie that's just like
okay.
these little gerbils in business suits.
Right,
like
that's,
I would watch that.
Really
they don't even
hours,
need to talk. Like,
I would like freak out.
Well, you know what? I'd go about my day, but like leave it on the TV and I could come and go and just like watch these gerbils and their
you
business
these gerbils
stream
and just go
gerbils oh.
in the background your whole day just
yeah.
gerbils like talking
and like the hamster. I'd love it. Disney, you heard it here first. There's a market for just
you got fans for gerbil movies.
Or the hamsters or no, what were they? They were lemmings. They were lemmings.
Scott, maybe you should make that film. That should be your first feature film.
Yeah.
Maybe it will be Scott Yonker's Lemming.
Gerbtopia.
A film by Scott Yonker. So the central character of this movie is a very adorable bunny rabbit.
Judy
Hopps, played by Jennifer Goodwin, an actress who I'm not that familiar with at all. Laura, are you?
Mm-mm, no.
So, okay, so none.
Now that I'm looking at the photo of her, she's in What's Upon a Time in Hollywood.
She looks like the rabbit.
Yeah. She does look like the
rabbit. She looks like the rabbit from the movie.
Yeah, that's a
yeah.
cool trick they did with this film, is that these animals look
right, like
just like their actors. It's a weird trick.
Who played the parents? of of Judy, because I feel like those actors, they had this type of look to them, where they could have been the actual actors. I'm trying to look through it now.
While Gian's doing that, I'm gonna kind of propel the plot forward. So Judy Hopps is a brave little bunny who wants to become the first bunny police officer in Zootopia, and very quickly, within the first like 10 minutes or so of the film, she achieves that goal. She's assigned to the station in downtown Zootopia, where she quickly learns that she is not welcome there because she is a bunny. They relegate her to, you know, being a meter maid, putting tickets on illegally parked cars. She hates her job until she meets Nick Wilde, a con artist fox, played by Jason Bateman.
He did a good job. I liked him in it.
You know what? He was good. Like, I had some. I think his voice work was good. Like, I think he gave a good performance. I had some problems with this character, though, in the beginning of the film, who I felt was supposed to be, like, a charming rogue,
right,
but just came off as, like, this, like, well, the words I would use to describe him I can't say on the radio.
Super sarcastic character.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's just, like, a downer. It's, like, he's so nasty. Like, it kind of, like, it's just, like, oh, man, it's too real.
I like...
You're making it too real right now.
I like Judy Hopps, the rabbit character.
Yeah, she's very bubbly and enthusiastic.
The thing is, like, I told you after we saw the movie, like, I could have totally seen this film as, like, a real human... feature film with like actors and like with these same actors, but like an actual human movie. I could have totally seen it the way the story played out.
And you want to break that down as, oh man, sorry. Do you want to break that down as?
Drop the mic.
I did drop the mic. You want to break that down as to what you mean by that? Like in terms of cinematography.
No, I think it was with the voiceover work.
The voiceover work,
but also with the storyline of how things occurred, like with her graduating the police academy and becoming a meter maid at first, and the way she meets the fox. I could have totally seen that play out as like this female officer that graduates from the police academy. She enters like New York City, and they set her up as a meter maid, and she meets this con artist. And you catch my drift here?
Yeah. No.
Like in my head, I totally see it. And that's why this movie, it sat so well with me because it did that.
It was definitely like the story writing, the plot was pretty like, you know, it could have played out as an actual live action film, had all of those elements. But the reason why I'm kind of trying to speed through the the synopsis of the film is because the reason why we have Laura on here is because we all have some pretty interesting theories about this movie, what it's about, what it's trying to say.
Yep.
So that's what I'm trying to.
And that has something to do with why I think that they did make it animals, because the theory that I have about what this movie's about, it wouldn't have worked with people.
Uh huh.
At least as a children's movie. Well, we're gonna get into that.
Yeah, we're gonna get into that.
That's
so
what I was thinking.
So Nick Wilde. You know, she coerces him into helping her find the 14 missing animals that you heard about in the clip we played. And of course, you've seen this character development arc hundreds of times before in children's movies, especially in children's movies, of the character who's kind of a jerk. And then there's that moment where you realize like something happened in his childhood,
that
and like
guy turned
that's
good.
Why he's nasty. But now you know he's redeemed himself, and now he's good, and you're cheering for him.
You know what? I mean, that's a great thing that they do in children's films, but like it happens so often.
Oh, they do it all the time, but I'm a sucker for it.
Yeah. And every time you see it like it's the first time it ever happened.
Yeah.
You're like, oh my god, he turned good. Aww.
I buy into it every time.
Really,
not gonna lie.
It's Scott's fault.
Like, oh, they got me again.
It did.
They got me.
So they go on this adventure to find these missing animals. Meet all sorts of funny characters on the way. Including probably the best was the I think he was a shrew or a vole. Who played.
A vole?
His name was Mr. Big, and Mr. Big.
Oh, that was the baby.
Minuscule little rodent who.
Well, let me find who that was.
No, yeah, we're not talking about elephant guy. We're talking about
I know the little baby fox, right?
No,
Mr. Big. Mr. Big is
the godfather.
Godfather. He's like Don Corleone, the godfather, and he sits in his little armchair.
That part cracked me up.
I love that.
And
so much.
Like that, he's a recurring character of just like.
Oh, he's an Arctic shrew.
An Arctic shrew. That's why he lives in Tundra Town. Okay.
An Arctic shrew.
Arctic shrew.
So, he's
what was the line? You could build a deal by blood and blood.
Yeah, give us a little more.
So what was it?
Freeze him.
What was the rug of the fox?
Made out of skunk fur.
Skunk fur. You know what?
But it was like skunk. Butt fur.
So, but you know what? I think we have that.
Do you have it?
We're gonna play that clip.
Ooh.
Introducing Mr. Big into the film.
Mr. Big, which is really small.
Are we
getting anything?
I'm gonna start calling myself Mr. Big.
Mr. Big. Now, are you guys hearing anything?
No. Oh well.
There we go. Right now. All right, we're gonna restart that. Had a little.
Spin that. You ever seen that 8 Mile? They tell
no,
the DJ spin that.
I kinda do
want to
see
stuff.
It.
Here we go.
Boss in Tundra Town. They call him Mr. Big, and he does not like me. So we gotta go.
Leaving? This is a crime scene.
Well, it's gonna be an even bigger crime scene if Mr. Big finds me here. So we're leaving right now.
Turn up in here. So.
Raymond, and is that Kevin? Long time no see. And speaking of no see. How about you forget you saw me? Huh? For old time's sake? That's a no.
That's why Jason Bateman's character, doesn't want to have a run-in with Mr. Big.
No.
For me, the implication, for one, if you sold him in this world, all the animals, they're the equivalents of humans, right?
Yeah.
So if you sold him
a rug?
Like, he skinned, like, a dead, the equivalent of, like,
well,
a dead person.
It was a skunk butt, so maybe he just skinned his butt and left him alive.
But that's, like, taking somebody's hair.
I mean, that's...
Like, scalping him,
gross,
but, like,
but
on the
scalping. You know, that extreme. Like, I shave your head and I make someone, like, a scarf or, like, something, or, like, a gloves.
Yeah, but, like...
Like, what? What
but, like,
the,
a rug, it's, like, the skin's
hair
on the bottom because you got the tan. But I somehow feel like... Jason Bateman's character Nick might have killed a skunk and then tanned its hot pelt and sold it to Mr.
Throw a little subliminals in there.
Kill skunks. He might have killed somebody. We don't know. We don't know how bad he is.
That's what they did with the dogs. They killed all the dogs. Or they eat dogs.
Maybe that's why the dogs are in the movie. Also, yeah, they have the weird I think they do a pretty good job of saying okay, so nobody's eating each other in this film.
Mm-hmm.
They've adapted or they've evolved?
Yeah, they've evolved. Like the predators and the prey live in peace. They don't eat each other anymore, or the predators don't eat the prey anymore.
Yeah.
So
what did they eat?
They don't tell you.
Food.
I just guess they're all vegetarians.
What did we see them eat? Well, they ate ice pops.
Yeah.
They did eat ice pops.
I saw them eating ice pops.
And that my favorite character, he eats donuts, the big fat cheetah.
Mr. Clawhauser, Officer Clawhauser.
Wait, she made a carrot, so they eat carrots.
Yeah,
they made pie. Remember those pies and stuff?
Blueberries. Okay, so they eat fruit, vegetables, ice pops, and donuts.
It's a kid's movie.
That's
so
pretty great diet. I'm not gonna lie.
They eat sprinkles and smiles.
You're not too far off the mark.
Yeah.
So this movie. It's definitely a great children's movie. As a movie as a whole, it's pretty solid. But this movie, it's been getting a lot of attention because it's got this very heavy-handed, incredibly heavy-handed, overarching metaphor or analogy, you could say,
Is this about, from our point of view, or have you...
This
part is, like, pretty obvious.
Yeah, like...
Have you even seen this in other places?
Oh, yeah, like, okay, like a think piece ran in, like,
NPR,
New York Times.
I mean, I feel like
you'd
have to be, like, a conspiracy theorist to not know that this movie's about, like, race.
Yeah.
Yeah, leaving there, we right off the back, we had this conversation.
Oh, yeah. Like, literally, like, not even that far into the film, like, less than a quarter of the film, it was like, oh,
and
this is about race.
We got a perfect clip to exemplify how this movie is about race that we're going to play for you right now. And then we're going to dive in about how, like, if they did a good job of handling the topic. In my opinion, it got pretty heavy-handed and too in your face
great.
At some
for
point.
For me, it was great.
Okay. Well, I'm going to play the scene, and then, like, for me, epitomizes, like, the most, like, painfully obvious.
And then
moment.
After, we'll break it down.
Yeah, we'll break it down.
I'll break it down.
So, and also, this is the scene where we meet Laura's favorite character, Officer Clawhauser.
Down here? Hi.
O.M. goodness. They really did hire a bunny.
What?
I gotta tell you, you are even cuter than I thought you'd be.
Ooh, you probably didn't know, but a bunny can call another bunny cute, but when other animals do it, it's a little...
I am so sorry. Me, Benjamin Clawhauser. The guy everyone thinks is just a flabby donut-loving cop stereotyping you. Oh.
It's okay. Oh, you've actually got... There's a...
What?
In your neck, the fold... What? The... There's...
Oh, there you went, you little dickens! Oh.
I should get a roll call. So, which way do I...
Oh, bullpen's over there to the left.
Great. Thank you.
Aww. That poor little buddy's gonna get eaten alive.
Alrighty, so Officer Clawhauser had a donut stuck in his fat fold.
Fat fold in his neck.
So, I really don't think that scene needs any explaining when we're talking about this film is about race. With the...
Only
a bunny can call another bunny.
Yeah.
The weird thing is, though, later in the film, I mean, obviously it makes it seem like the bunny is, like, the minority group, but then it turns around at the end.
Yeah, you want to talk about that, Laura, how, like, the film, it begins where you think, okay, the prey are the minority group and...
Yeah, because, I mean, the whole beginning of the film, it sets it up, like, she's the first bunny cop, like, she's, you know, and then everyone's, like, you know, making fun of her, putting her down, that whole scene happens... and then there's, like, this sheep who's, like, the assistant mayor of Zootopia, who's always like, oh, yeah, us little animals need to stick together, like, stuff like that. So you think the whole time that, like, she's, like, the minority group, but then, like, toward the end of the film, well, we didn't explain this yet, but there's this whole, like, the whole plot is what ends up happening is, like, there's, like, this, not like a drug, it's like a plant or something that's, like, making some of the animals,
well,
like...
kind
of
is, like, a drug. Well,
yeah, I mean, I guess, like, in their world, it's, like, a drug. But, like, it...
No, in our world, it's a drug. To them, it's a plant.
Yeah, but it, like, reverts...
Because it's a kid's movie, they can't be, like...
They sell it as a plant.
...of heroin.
Yeah, they sell it as a plant.
But, no, it's totally a drug, because you have to synthesize the plant into... It's, like, basically how you make,
it's a drug. So it's a drug.
They don't
It's a drug, man. Those animals were tripping...
okay, anyway.
Yeah.
Okay, well, let me explain, though. So, it makes the animals, like, revert back to, like, their natural, like, animal state where they just, like, don't have morals and they just, like, want to attack other animals and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And so, what ends up happening is, the, like, Zootopia finds out about that this is happening, that, like, animals are, like, going savage, and, they see that it's only predator animals that this is happening to.
Yes.
So... Then this whole scene happens where Judy's, like, at a press conference, and they're like, why is it only predators? And she's like, oh, maybe it's, like, because, like, in the past, predators used to be, like, you know, more savage or whatever. They used to want to eat prey animals, so that it must be biological or something. And so then it has this whole montage of, like, situations where, like, the predator animals are, like, being discriminated against, and everyone's seeing them as, like, these, like, scary, like, people. Like, there's this part where they're, like, on the train or something, and then, like, there's, like, these, I don't remember what kind of prey animal they were, but, like, some prey animal, and then, like, this, like, jaguar or something, like, sits next to them, and then, like, the mother animal, like, pulls, like, her daughter animal closer to her.
Yeah.
It, you know, it's very, like, like, heavy-handed, like, this, like, how this happens in real life
totally
between, like, and different races. Yeah.
And
the predators.
Also, for one, yes, the movie, like, posits in the beginning that it's the prey that they're... are the discriminating against minority, and then it flip-flops, and at the end it's like, oh, no, it's the predators. And Laura and I were discussing before the show, oh, maybe she's not being discriminated against because she's a bunny, but because she's a woman. But no, they explicitly say in the film it's because she's a bunny.
She's a bunny, yeah.
And then the other weird thing is that...
Actually, really quick, I think they sell that she's because she's a bunny,
yeah.
But in our world it's because she's a woman. And
maybe.
I feel like it's because she's a woman in maybe... In our world, that's how it would have been sold. But for the kids, it's because she's a bunny.
But, I honestly feel like it's just shoddy storytelling. Because I feel like if it's because she's a woman, like, you could just say that. Because you're already having the predator-prey thing as, like, a metaphor for race. But also, like, you've got some weird and not entirely good implications going on there. Because if the predators represent minorities, and, like, if in the film, like, that's pretty explicit in the film, like, that's what they represent. And then you have, like, obviously in the film's world, like, this isn't taken as gospel truth. This is taken, like, in the film's world, it's recognized as being false. But, like, their theory that, oh, you know, the predators are turning savage because they used to be in the past. Like, and if the predators are supposed to be, like, black people, like...
That's not an oversight.
Yeah.
Well, it could have been any minority group, black.
Yeah,
Hispanic,
it doesn't matter,
Latino.
But like it's.
Yeah.
But like that implication that they were like savage or less than in the past,
you,
like
when
that's.
When you make an allegory like that, you gotta like be careful because.
Very, very much so.
Yeah, because I found myself, once I realized the whole race allegory was happening, I was like trying to match everything up to real life. Like, what does this mean in real life? Like, what does this represent? So, like,
I think the problem with doing an allegory, perhaps of any kind, but especially with such a subject like race, is that, like, once you dip your toes in the water, like, people are going to start reading things into everything, and so you have to be very mindful. Like, as the filmmaker, you may only intend certain things to be allegorical. Or metaphorical. I'm probably butchering the correct usage of these words.
Okay. I do it.
But you have things that crop up like that, whereas like you have that implication, which I'm sure was not intended, but as an audience member, you still catch that and you're like, wait, what are you trying to say in this movie?
Like, you know, what I was just saying before, they sell it to kids. I think that's like their target audience.
Oh.
So that's why the things they sell that they can get away with because the kids are watching.
Definitely.
And because the parents aren't going to explain to their kids, oh, this is what's really going on.
Yeah.
This is the true story about what this means and what that means. They're just going to watch it with their kids and then they're going to break it down and maybe have a conversation with their spouse about what's going on. And that's what, you know.
Yeah. As a kid's movie, like, to some degree, it's like, on like a children's movie level, why would we, you don't really... have to bother like reviewing a movie because like kids like their standards are lower. Like,
just like, oh, I like the colors.
Like the kids, they're gonna have a great time when they go see this movie. But like for people like us who for some reason felt compelled to review Zootopia.
I'm glad you picked this one because when Scott first told me he was let's go see Zootopia. I was like, okay.
There's a fracture.
But I'm
in the spoiler alert.
In the theater, I was sitting next to this kid, like breathing at 1,000 miles an hour, and his dad screaming and shouting.
The worst part of the movie was the atmosphere. Gian, you want to break this down for us?
Oh man, it was me, Scott, and Laura sitting there amongst like 100 kids and parents, and it wasn't the kids that were a problem because like you know kids are great. I love kids. I work with kids over the summers. It was the parents that were just annoying. Because these parents go in there and they're like the big kid parents. They're not the regular parents, they're like adult parents. They're like the adult parents that are like their kids and live through their kids and are more excited for the Disney movies than their kids are.
Yeah, they're like, they laugh obnoxiously at every joke.
Oh,
yeah.
And the worst is during the trailers. I don't know about you, when I go to a theater, I want to pay attention to those trailers. I want to watch my commercials.
You got dads going, that looks great. Angry Birds comes on. This guy next to me, he was probably like in his 40s, 50s. He's like, oh, looks great. I can't wait to see Angry Birds. And I was like, no.
That, you know that man is slowly dying.
I really hope he was selling it like that for his son. I really hope so. That's how I'm going to think about it. Because if this man is raising a child, if you have an Angry Bird fan raising a child, that's not right. to remove that child from his household.
Oh.
Yeah. I don't believe in that.
Okay, all
right. My dad loves Angry Birds. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Kids at that age won't question it, but I question it.
If you saw Zootopia at Regal on a Friday night and you happen to be a 50-year-old man who likes Angry Birds.
Like, we are.
All power to you, just hope you don't have any kids.
Okay, you know, I think this is a great time to take our first musical interlude. We'll come back and we'll spit theories about this movie. So, first up, we're gonna do Gian's.
Well, I gotta do a shout out before
forget. Oh, let's do it.
Do a shout out. Don't forget. Shout out to Christina Cardona, my lady friend.
Wow.
My best pal, ride or die lady. She's out there listening. She's my supporter, my number one fan, and my number one critic.
Alrighty, Christine, this goes out to you. Some Michael Jackson right here.
The stream time. Hello and welcome back to the show.
Oh my!
What was that?
Is that a good one? Is that a good one?
What was that?
I don't know. I was trying to do an accent. Hello and welcome back to the show here at Spoiler Alert on 90.3 FM. No? I don't even know what that is. I'm just trying to do something that doesn't sound like
it. It sounds like...
I'm going to keep that like, the rest of the show.
Like 18th century British street urchin. Like, that's kind of the vibe I was getting.
Yes, dickery dickery dock. The mouse ran up the clock.
Okay.
All
right,
no,
stop. Okay.
Sorry.
Okay. So this portion of the show, we're gonna talk about kind of revolve around the weird, well, not weird, just like heavy-handed, like whole race thing going on in this movie. Also, I want to get on my soapbox and talk about furries.
Are you really?
I didn't know you were gonna go there.
There's some tension between some of these characters, man.
Here we go.
But no, we'll see. If we have time, I'll go into that. But no, this is why we have Laura on the show.
Yes.
Laura has very she's got a theory for us.
Only the truth.
She is our today. She's our resident Fox Mulder conspiracy theorist. Like,
okay.
We're coming in,
Doctor.
Aliens
doctor,
are among us.
Doctor French.
Dr.
French,
okay,
here.
So
you've been brought before the spoiler alert panel to discuss your findings.
Okay, so here's my findings.
What are your findings?
Okay, obviously we know this movie's about race. Like I said, you have to be a conspiracy theorist to not think this movie's about race. But I think it goes deeper than that, and let me explain.
Okay.
So like I said, after I watched this movie, the whole, like, that night and the day after, I was, like, thinking, I was like, what does it all mean? Like, what does this mean? Like, why is the bunny, like, the first bunny cop? Like, what is, and then, like, I was like, what does it mean to go savage? Like, what is that an allegory for in real life that, like, we, like, if we were to talk about, like, let's say, predators are people of color, what does that represent in, like, people of color, like, to go savage? So I was talking to my dad about it, my dad, who's also named Scott, actually, and I was like, yeah, like, I watched this movie.
Coinkadink?
I've heard that. Well, coinkadink.
Sorry.
You never heard me say that?
I've never heard of a coinkadink. Proceed.
Anyway, so, so I was like, yeah, I watched this movie, and it's about race, and, like, there's animals and stuff, and he was like, okay, and I was like, yeah, there's, like, this thing that, like, oh, and this part I actually didn't explain yet. So it turns out the drug, it's called Night Howlers, is, like, the plant that it comes from. So it turns out the whole time this is spoiler alert, so I'm about to spoil the whole thing. The sheep, the little sheep mare, who was like, oh, we gotta stick together, we're the little guys. So it turns out she, like, has this whole conspiracy where she's, like, paying, like, or she's, like, in cahoots with other sheep who are, like, shooting this, like, purposely at predators to single out predators and, like, keep the prey animals in power.
Uh-huh.
And the prey animals are, like, she's, like, oh, yeah, we're 90%, and the 90% of us have to, like, be in power over, like, the 10%, and they can't fight us, and I'm gonna shoot every predator in the city with this night howl and make them savage, right? So I was telling my dad that,
ooh,
right?
I'm thinking about, like, what that translates to.
Well, I think that's what Laura's getting to.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Good. So I was told my dad, I was like, I just don't know what going savage means. I don't know what this, like, night howler thing is. And my dad was like, well, maybe it's drugs. And I was like, oh, my God. I was, like, in the car with him, right? He was, like, he stopped at the mail, and he's, like, getting the mail. And I was just like, oh, my God, you're right, what? And he was like, are you okay? Like, all I said was drugs. And I was like, no, you cracked the code. So, like, I went back. I called Scott and Gian immediately. I was like, listen, I know what this movie's about. So... This is a history lesson here. So back in the 80s.
Wait, before we get like sued by the Reagan estate.
Okay, I'm not gonna say it was Reagan, but this happened during Reagan's presidency.
Okay,
real life.
Yes,
not Zootopia land.
Now we're gonna say like I'm not allowed to say things.
No. I'm joking.
So the CIA.
We do a speech, man.
CIA.
Okay. I'm gonna say this is a theory. I'm not gonna say
this is not legally actionable.
This is a theory.
Okay. So basically, the CIA, people believe the CIA was in cahoots with drug traffickers to fund, like, rebels in Nicaragua. But basically, what ended up happening is
that was definitely a real thing.
Oh, no, that was a real thing, yeah.
Yeah, like,
but basically,
that is proved.
But then what happened through this is that crack cocaine, like, made its way into, like, poor communities of color. Mm-hmm. Like, it wasn't as much of a problem before that, and then after all the CIA stuff happened, like,
mm-hmm.
like that's when drugs became a big problem, and that's also when the whole war on drugs started happening, where they were, like, lock people up for having 2 ounces of marijuana and stuff like that. So what I think is that the sheep who is purposely putting the night howlers, you know, shooting the predators with these night howlers, it's like the government purposely putting crack cocaine into communities of color, and then, because... Then, like, when the predators are discovered to, like, be the ones that are all going savage, like, oh, lock them up. Just lock them all up, right?
Yeah.
So, think about it. Like, the government put crack cocaine into communities of color and then was locking them up for doing cocaine. Like,
that's
what it matches up with. The sheep is giving the night howlers to the predators and then locking them up for being savage. That's what I think this movie's about.
You heard it here first. Zootopia is a coded... secret history of the United States in which President Ronald Reagan personally funneled crack cocaine.
Let me say, I'm not the only person who thinks this, because I immediately went onto the old Google and I typed in, Zootopia War on Drugs, CIA, and let me tell you, there is at least one other person who actually got on top of this before
there
I did.
There must be forums out there now.
And wrote, you know what, yeah. I have my iPad here, I can look it up right now. I bet you there is.
Does former First Lady Nancy Reagan's recent death play into this, this in any fashion?
Only
was she silenced by the directors of Zootopia?
Okay, no, listen. Okay. I actually saw a petition to have Fetty Wap perform at Nancy Reagan's, to perform Trap Queen at Nancy Reagan's funeral. I'm gonna try to be respectful, but the reason was because they're saying, oh, like, your husband put drugs in the black community,
uh-huh.
like, and that's why, you know, there are trap queens and stuff like that. So we should have Fetty Wap perform trap queen. And, I don't know. That was what I read. So it kind of looked like,
so,
you know.
Yeah, I know. No.
It was like a winky dink.
It's kind of disrespectful, but I kind of want to see it.
Yeah.
Like a live stream of Fetty Wap at a funeral. I don't know.
If I die before Fetty Wap, please have him perform at my funeral.
We'll make sure. We'll get him there. We'll book him.
All right. Thanks, Scott.
Now I'm thinking about who I want to perform at my funeral.
You know.
Maybe Drake? I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
That's too predictable. Everyone knows that. Maybe like Sting.
Sting.
Or like
Sting's
or Dave
boring.
Matthews. Or Dave Matthews.
You're so white, Gian.
Whoa.
This whole podcast is about race.
For the record, Gian is
a huge shot at me.
Gian is biologically the least white person in this room.
No, yeah, this is true.
Whatever.
Gian, is like, biologically, I am the whitest person in this room, but Gian's just like Dave Matthews, like Sting, like.
No? All right. Whatever.
That's like middle-aged white man music, Gian. Maybe. But you know what? I'm not going to hold that against you.
Leave me alone. I'm confused.
Okay, so.
I like it all.
This article I just found, it's suggesting that it might also be a metaphor for the war on terror, where the predator animals represent Muslims, and. But that's not.
That's
another good theory, though.
That's pretty good theory.
I'm gonna stick with the drug thing, because the night howlers is clearly, like, mm-hmm. a substance
I think that fits...
Yeah.
I can't speak grammar. Like, way much more better. Does that sentence even make sense?
Betterer.
camera woman Janine is shaking her head. Then the terrorism theory, because, like, if the predators are, like... Muslims. Like, the entire police force of the movie is made up of...
Okay, okay.
Muslims.
Okay, here's the original article that I saw on screencrush.com.
Okay.
I'm going to give credit to this person. Mike Sampson had the same idea as me 6 days ago.
Okay.
And this is the opening two paragraphs of his article.
Okay.
As the story goes, corrupt government officials intentionally introduced a dangerous drug into marginalized minority communities, resulting in increased power for politicians and law enforcement through the manipulated fear of the middle class. This narrative has been the subject of a number of popular conspiracy theories over the years concerning the CIA's alleged involvement in the crack cocaine epidemic among the African-American community in the mid-80s. It's also the plot of the 55th Disney animated movie starring a group of cute talking animals. So, yeah.
What a better way to just show it.
Yeah, I think he put it better than I could, that this movie is about the CIA drug trafficking. But,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, because, I mean, that still doesn't explain why the bunny rabbit is, like, the discriminated one in the beginning.
I think that's where it gets all fuzzy, because it's a children's movie.
Fuzzy.
You can't...
Because they're animals.
Because they're animals. But, you know what I mean? When you translate it...
Yeah.
When something gets translated into, like, Spanish or French, it doesn't always translate the same.
Yeah.
I think that's what happens here with this whole theory and human, like, film and animated film.
Yeah, I think...
Or children's film and adult film.
That's true. Storytelling. It could just be poor storytelling. Or they just, like, only the latter half of this film is going to project us into this.
Great effort, though.
I think the Night Howlers are clearly drugs, though, because they have an extended gag where the manufacturers of Nightcrawler, where they take the berry and, like, you know, reduce it into this powerful, like, serum that they then fashion into, like, a paintball.
It's
that
like
they
a
then,
drug lab.
It is a drug lab.
Yeah.
Like, he's in the Walter White yellow suit, and like,
where can I get some Night Howler?
And he's got like a meth lab operation going on, and his side cats. I got animals on the brain.
Scott caught what I got. Mispronunciation.
Yeah, you know, usually that's Gian's forte, but not today.
Sidecack.
His sidekicks, two goats their names are Jesse and Walter, and that's clearly a shout out to Breaking Bad. It's about crystal meth. If you didn't know that, you've been living under a meth rock. Anyone? Yeah. That tanked. Ignore that. Alrighty.
Crickets.
I should be ashamed.
I tried
of
to make
myself.
A cricket sound there. You tried to hear that?
No.
Yeah. I'm like, because that's a cricket sound.
We have a cricket noise on the soundboard. I don't know what button it is.
Press
though.
A random one. Let's press whatever one. Press it. Go ahead.
We're gonna press a random button.
Random. And see if it's a cricket.
Okay. Here we go.
Oh, that's not a cricket. Oh, that's an applause.
I don't know. Next time.
It's like 9:16.
Next time,
we'll find the next one. Okay, you know what? Laura pointed out it's 9:16, and actually, from my vantage point, I'm watch. It's 1, 2, 3. It's 9:17. A great time for our second or deny, whether or not.
Yeah, you really shouldn't.
Whiskey makes me crazy. So
Scott's underage.
This is this film. So I don't Laura has definitely swayed my opinion. I shouldn't think this film is about crack cocaine.
I'm like 98% sure that this is what the Disney people were thinking of.
Probably.
Yeah.
So you know what? Should I discuss? Should we have a round table discussion about furries? This movie.
I think we should start first.
Which what?
I think we should give
star ratings.
Before
okay,
we get
hey, so Laura, so as you know, we use the 10-star system here.
Yeah.
Five stars and half stars don't go here.
Gian's a big fan of using decimal points when rating films.
Like, yeah,
I believe last week
like,
it was 7.8.
I like using like, I'll do like throw in like a 0.1 or something,
you know,
just
you know.
To like be
keep,
a troll.
Keep us on our toes, you know. So, Laura, you want to do us the honors and start off?
Yeah, well, actually, I told you this before. I was talking to some friends, and they were like, well, on a scale from 1 to 10, what would you rate it? And I was like, an 8.6. Like, I did play to Gian, and I was like, an 8.6 or something. And they were like, as, like, a kid's movie or as, like, as a movie in general? And I was like, I don't know. But I'd say if I had to just do it, like, out of, like, 10, I'd probably give it, like, an 8. because it was like good. It was decent.
Yeah.
For a kids movie, it was pretty good. Like an 8 as like a movie, not as a kids movie.
Yeah.
But it did, like a 9 would be like really exceptional, and then like a 10 would be perfect. Yeah. So I think an 8 is fair.
I'd agree. I would say, yeah, I think when you're judging kids movies, like that's totally different territory than judging a regular film, because of course a children's film, like it's a very specific genre that is catering to younger children, and it makes sure to have no you know, drugs or sex or anything in it. In fact, I read there's a pretty good essay out there by Roger Ebert. He talks about how like there. Yeah, he's pretty dope.
R.I.P.
Yeah, let's have a moment of silence for Roger Ebert. Okay, there we go. this essay, I'm rambling, but he's talking about how there are almost no good movies that are not rated R, because to tell a good story, there are a lot of elements or a lot of great story components, you know.
I could agree.
Fall under an R rating. But so a kid's movie, because, like, you know, pretty much by definition they have none of that, you definitely have to like judge them on a different scale. So as a kids movie, this was pretty great, and I think as a I would probably rate it around like probably like 8 or 9, but then as a regular movie I still think it's pretty decent. Like I said, like I think like my biggest problem, I did have some problems, like I said, with Jason Bateman's his character's characterization in the beginning of the film. Like, I felt like his dialogue could have been better. And, of course, like, his character turnaround, like, while you see it coming, you take it as a given that he's going to become a good guy. That turnaround is still very rewarding. It's still very rewarding. But I guess my biggest problem that detracts it in terms of rating is that they're so clearly trying to say something about race in America, but they kind of fumble the ball. They kind of stumble a little bit in the beginning of this movie. So that's the big point for me. The caveat is that, like, if you're gonna go out of your way to make a point about race in America, like, do it well. And in the beginning of this movie, it felt half baked. That's not like that. It's a great movie. It's pretty darn good movie.
Did you give it a star?
You know, I think I'm gonna agree with Laura, like an 8.
An 8?
Solid 8.
Between a 7.9 and 8.1.
Solid 8. Right there.
Right in the middle.
Does this little British street urchin that keeps speaking running in?
He has a little British guy in my head.
Does he have a name?
No, I don't really have a name for him.
Okay.
What's your name?
John Carl.
Like
J-O-H-N. Yeah.
Actually, my name translates to John Charles, so I think I'm gonna call him John Charles.
John Charles.
So John Charles lives in my head.
Can John Charles give your star rating?
Oh man, I gotta do this.
Hey right, man, right, you I'll made it, your I'll own bed here.
All right, same. I'll give it a rating. I'm going to write Zootopia.
Uh-huh.
At a 9.
A 9.
Usually I butcher movies, but I think this one's a 9.
It's a 9.
And you're the one who was like, oh, I'm Zootopia.
No, I liked it. I read it. I liked the hidden messages. I thought it was a great film. I really did.
I think I like John Charles better than John Carl.
Do you really?
John Charles, what is your day job? Are you like a chimney sweep?
No, I work on a dock.
You work on a dock? Okay.
On a dock.
Like, you're a fishmonger, perhaps?
Nobody knows. I do it
hawking
all.
Your wares?
I do it all. I also walk the streets at night. I am a man of the night.
Okay. We got like 5 minutes to talk about furries if they want to get it in.
Yeah, I give it 9.
Like, I don't know if I'm looking forward to this. Dragons. But I furries. Ours. So going to this movie, I got really excited.
No offense to any furries.
Oh! cares about furries' feelings. I'm going to say it right here.
There's nothing about furries in this.
Well, okay, so I don't think I got excited going into this movie because I saw all this buzz on the internet, which, of course, you can believe that, like, this movie's catering to furries and that, like, they
if you don't know what furries are, go Google it because we're not going to break
just,
it down.
Google it. What a furry make is. Sure you're not in a public place.
Just, like, a safe search on... Don't even do Google.
Don't Google it around your mom.
I think it's on Wikipedia. Like, if you Wikipedia furries, you can probably find
the show. The Disney company, they're reaching out to the furry community to, like, crowd promote this film. So, you know, we went to the film, like, Laura and I, we brought binoculars. We were on the lookout for some furries in their fursuits. Didn't see any, and this film really disappointed me in that I did not see any blatant catering to furries. Except, I gotta say, I thought that there was tangible sexual tension between the fox and Judy Hopps.
I'm gonna disagree with you, Scott.
Okay. I really felt some tension going on. I felt some tension going on between Mayor Bellwether and Judy Hopps. I think the mayor, the little cute sheep. I think she was.
Okay, that's not.
That's I'm.
Ooh. I don't know, man. I feel like
as I caress the wall.
I don't know. I feel like
you that's don't coming think from this a place. Children's movie.
I think that's coming from a place where it's like, oh, there's a male, female, and a there's a male character and a female character, and they're totally in the same room and they're talking to each other. Oh, they're in love.
I thought they were in love. You know, as they gaze into each other's eyes and
I thought they had a great friendship.
Okay, that's all right. Okay. I have an argument here.
Actually,
everyone wants to be friends nowadays. Obviously, you know what? It's true. Sometimes men and women just can't be friends. There are things out there that just happens. I'm going to argue it because I don't believe in that. I don't believe in that. They're just friends. I mean, obviously, men and women can be friends, but there are some instances where it just.
Laura. I gotta clear the air.
Laura doesn't like
why,
that.
Why is it, Laura? Like, I'm gonna. Oh, yeah, you're right, Joe. You know what? You're right. Men and women can't be friends.
Okay, you're they so can. No, but there's.
Wait.
Let me break it down for myself.
Oh, break it down.
We have 3 minutes.
Hey, it's cool. I gotta admit, I was being facetious when I said there was sexual tension between a rabbit.
I figured you were.
And just in case that was clear. That said, let's jump. Let's dive into this.
Here we go.
Let's go. Let's go.
30% of the time.
30%.
I feel like Dr. Drew. You ever seen Dr. Drew on like VH1? He's like a relationship doctor.
Dr. Drew on HLN?
No, forget it. Not that guy. I don't know what you're talking about.
There's two Dr.
Phil, Dr. Oz, Dr. Drew. Which one is it? Dr. Dre?
I don't know. So
it wasn't Dr. Dre.
30% of the time, these are my breakdowns, my scientific research.
Okay, professor.
Okay. 30% of the time, men and women can be friends.
Uh-huh.
70% of the time, it does not work out because something happens.
So that 30% is platonic?
I'll say 40% of the time, they can be friends, and 60,
like,
something happens that the friendship can't. Like, I don't know. I feel like women and women can have longer relationship, like, friendships than men.
Because men suck.
No, I agree with that. Some of my fellow men brothers out there, they are not the greatest creatures.
Happy, uh-huh. Happy International Women's Day, you guys.
It's a circle. We brought it back. That's how we started the night.
Hail women. But, yeah. So, I don't know. You could agree or disagree. That's my theory.
Mm-hmm.
You can either, you know, because things happen. I just, like, me and Scott... this bromance.
And but if Scott was a beautiful woman, you couldn't do
keep
it.
Someone would keep us apart.
No, because I don't know. It just, I'm just stop. I'll just halt my comments. You catch my drift.
Yeah.
Oh, Gian, you're one of a kind.
Gian, never change, Gian.
John Chara is from.
Oh, John Chara's back. He's back. Okay, so you know where we got 30 seconds left.
Can John Charles take it out?
Let's have John Charles take us out.
The new character, a fourth member of our crew.
Okay, John Charles, take us out.
Thank you, everybody, for listening to another episode of Spoiler Alert. Tune in next week to our spoiling movies, watching them, spoiling them for you.
Alrighty, see you then.
Peace in the streets. Scott didn't let me say that.